Thank you. That young fellow up there is pretty impressive. I think I'll vote for him. My problem is now, after that beautiful introduction, what should I run for? I'm 91 and a half. They say after 90, only little children talk about half years. You know, I'm a year and a half or two and a half. After 90, you have to give the half year. I'm 90 and a half, 91 and a half. But Ted Walk, our chairman, thank you for conducting this meeting. And thank you all of you for coming out and giving up a good lunch hour for whatever you're going to get here. Believe you me, I am sort of turned on by this whole thing, that introduction by Ken, and then the film that I'd like to make a political speech here. But as I said a moment ago, I don't know exactly what I'd run for. My niece Amy's sitting out there. Will you conduct my campaign for me, Amy? Free of charge, of course. Don't have any money for it. She'll work with it. In any event, I was 70 years old before I started writing poetry. I thought poetry was for sissies. And I didn't want anyone to think I was a sissy. But, you know, by the time I was 70, I really didn't care anymore. They wanted to think I was a sissy, that was okay. I started writing poetry, mostly for family and friends and occasions. And when the spirit hit me, I'd sit down and try to write a poem. If I could get something down that I liked the first time, that was fine. If not, I'd put it aside and try it the second time. And if I couldn't do anything with the idea the second time, I'd throw the whole thing away and start over on something else. In any event, writing through the 70s, I knew it was I'd write it out in longhand and give it to my secretary, and she'd type it up and put it in a loose leaf binder. And I didn't refer back to it. I just kept writing through the 70s, through my 70s. And one time, you know, I might have 100 poems out there. So I said to my secretary, do you want to check and see how many poems we have out there? Because I used to use some of the poems in my speeches, and every once in a while somebody, in an effort to, is it carrying? And in an effort to be polite, would say, George, you ought to put those poems in a book. Well, you know, my ego being what it is, I wasn't opposed to that. But I said, when we checked, I said, I believe we have 100. And she counted them, and there were 250. I said, we really have enough for a book. So we did the first book of poems here. And while we were working on editing it, putting it in shape to publish, the idea struck me that there's a good deal in here has to do with our psychological and spiritual and physical well-being. And it struck me that maybe healing poems would be an appropriate title. So that's the title we gave the first book, which we brought out about 10 years ago. And then I kept on writing through my 80s. And one time I said to my secretary, I think we're getting an accumulation out there. We must have 10 or 12 poems out there now. And she counted them. There were over 100. You lose track when you're doing things in stages like that. And so I said, well, I think we'll do another book. And we did. To give you an idea where we were coming from in the first book of Healing Poems, I'll use a few of those to set the stage for what we might be doing in the Healing Poems number 2, which is the second book. The first one, if you turn, right after you turn past the page that has the title of the book and the name of the author in big print, there's a passage of scripture there that I think that states my philosophy of life pretty much. And it says, it's taken from Matthew 22. It says, for you shall love the Lord thy God with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole soul, and some interpretations say your whole strength. This is the first and most important commandment. And the second is like unto it, you should love your neighbor as yourself. And then it goes on to say, most people quit there. It goes on to say, on these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets. Now this is being said by a devout Jew, Jesus, who went to the synagogue when he was 12 years old and was bar mitzvahed. And he was following a religion that was based in a large measure on law. He's saying this replaces all the law and all the prophets. He was kind of a dissenter, wasn't he? And then I put under that, of course, a little lick of my own there, which says the essence of life is unconditional, non-judgmental love. And I really believe that very deeply, and I hope the poetry that I do and read today will carry that idea through to further elaboration. And the first poem in this book that I'd like to share with you is titled The Giving Samaritan. I was, as a child, I was very much impressed with the story of the Good Samaritan, and still am, by the way. And I wrote this poem, and I called it The Giving Samaritan. The robbers believed in the story divine that they should take it all, for what's yours is mine. Robbing just happens to be our line, and right at the moment, we're doing fine. The Levites felt in the lesson divine, I'm downright sure what's mine is mine. Helping the priest is my full-time line, so I'll pass him by, I'm doing fine. The priest agreed in the lesson divine, I have no doubt what's mine is mine. I'm just being pious is my full-time line. I'll just pass him by, I'm doing fine. But the Good Samaritan really knew that all that I have belongs to you. It's a gift from God, we know that's true. So I'll share what I have with this suffering Jew. It's been quite so since the world began that those who know the Creator's plan give and give as much as they can to ease the pain of their fellow man. And that's giving not to, sometimes we think giving, the only thing we give is money. Giving time may be the most precious thing we have. Because it's giving part of our life. I'm helping one of our former Pennsylvania prison chaplains in Ghana right now. And someone said, wasn't it nice that I'm giving him money? I said, I'm only giving him money. He's giving his life. He's giving all he's got. Anyhow, the second poem I'd like to read to you is titled, Be a Likewiser. Go and do thy likewise is truly what he said. He meant to feed each person's soul and fill their mouths with bread. He meant to help to heal the sick and comfort those who die. He meant to help in every way the old and young who cry. Then there are those in prison cells who really hurt so much. We need to visit them today and give a gentle touch. When I was governor, we had 7,000 in prison. When I started a prison program 10 years ago, there were 37,500. Today, there are 47,500 in our prisons. So I'm just talking about the state system, not the federal penitentiaries or the county jails. And we're just getting ready to go into a program where it's estimated we have to do 10,000 more jail cells at the state level in the next 6 or 8 years. I don't know where the money's going to come from, but it's funny. We'll just take it away from feeding the poor. We'll take it away from the sick, the old and the sick and the decrepit and the suffering. We'll just take it away from people who really, really need it. We'll build some more prison cells. Thank God New York and California are a little ahead of us in their thinking because they're releasing some of their prisoners who aren't particularly dangerous to themselves or other people. But we're going to go from 47,500 maybe to 57,500 or more, and my children and my grandchildren will pay the taxes. The budget right now is $1.5 billion a year, with another 10,000 cells, we should be able to spend $2 billion a year to maintain those prisons. It just costs almost as much to keep someone in prison as to send them to a college or a university, and I have a great idea. What we ought to do is take them out and send them to colleges and universities. It might work. Who knows? I'll bet the recidivism would go down. Right now, it's about 60% after 3 years. The word to Christians everywhere comes ringing through quite clear. We need to follow him right now and hold all mankind dear. The third one is from the original book, is on positive thinking. I'm a great believer. I've just recently been reading and studying a book that's more modern. It's called The Magnificent Mind by Daniel G. Amen, A-M-E-N. I strongly urge you to put out the $22 and buy a copy of that book. You'll learn more about the brain. He was in the 90s, around 1991, he started doing SPECT. That's an acronym. Don't ask me what it stands for, because I haven't memorized that. But he's been doing pictures of the brain, which not only pictures the surface, but like a CAT scan, all the slices of the brain. And they've done over 50,000 now. He's a psychiatrist. He probably knows more about the brain than anyone in the world right now, because he's looked at the pictures of so many of them. He said, all the other doctors, if they're a heart doctor, they got pictures of the heart in the inside of the heart. I had them look inside my heart, and the doctor said, look up there in the wall, you can see the camera inside your heart. And I said, I don't want to look. But 5 minutes later, he asked me again, and by that time, I got my courage up, and I looked, and I saw the camera dangling around inside my heart. It was being squished around by the blood. But he said the people who were working with the brain, the psychiatrists, they didn't bother to look at the brain. And that was the seat of the trouble. So he started on that in 1991, and that's a wonderful book, and you'll learn more about the brain in the first 100 pages of that book than you ever dreamed was even available from the scientific community. But this is be positive, and one of the things he recommends, by the way, in some of his treatments, and he deals with everything from Parkinson's and Alzheimer's to the seven types of depression. And some people seem to have all seven types, and it's a very serious matter. So what we're learning about the brain is fantastic. One of the things he says, in effect, he says, Dr. Allman, be positive. And this poem's titled Be Positive. As we travel through life with its joy and strife, we can consciously brighten each day, share our spiritual gift, and give others a lift by the things that we do and we say. Oh, there's always be some who prefer to be glum with a mind chock full of bad thoughts. They destroy their health, which is their greatest wealth, and ignore the real damage they've done. Now, I know it's far better to control thought to the letter and fill our minds with the best. There'll be joy each day as we work and we play, and we'll smile as we go to our rest. But you can almost look in some people's faces and see how negative their thinking must be and how unhappy they must be. And if you're unhappy, you're probably also less healthy than you'd like to be. So being positive. Those are the only three I'm going to do from the original book. And then I'm going to go over to the healing poems number two and read you a few of those. Charles Simic was named one of our poets laureate some months ago. And he said, poetry is to remind people of their own humanity. And I like to interpret humanity as love of mankind. Remind us of the beauties of the world, the beauties of civilization, the good side, the beauties of the people they know, the positive things about the people they know. And the first poem in this that I'd like to read to you in this second book is, If You Can Dream It. If you want to be successful, you'd better have a dream. Then your thoughts will be quite focused and will flow as in a stream. When the dream has permeated right down into your very pores, you can achieve most anything, like knocking down some doors. Success is never easy. You will struggle when you try to climb the highest mountain, reaching upward to the sky. Why is it that so many fail to make the final climb? Is it their lack of energy, or isn't this the time? I really don't pretend to know what makes the world go round. I only know some forge ahead with very little sound. Now, wouldn't you like to be the one who truly gains the heights, and vaulting over the rocks and hills, enjoy all the sights? So dream those dreams when you're young, and then you can pursue the great objective God has planned for people just like you. Don't get discouraged when things go wrong or setbacks come your way. If you are working on His plans, it may not be today. For He has a plan for you that really is the best. And if you give your life to Him, you'll surely pass the test. And another one titled, Why Do It? Why Do It? To live a good life is really a challenge, and only a few make the grade. But with love and compassion and tolerance too, our faith in the Lord will not fade. Oh, there will be times when some fall aside, as negative thoughts in their minds will reside. Perhaps they'll have trouble to really decide that God cares about them and is right by their side. Know you are doing good things because it is right. You even do good when you're quite out of sight. For God cannot do it, no matter his might, unless, like Mother Teresa, you follow his light. If all of us lived like Mother Teresa, the world would be a wonderful place. The world, love and compassion would rule every day, and God's noble spirit would shine from each face. More about Mother Teresa later. One called Friends of Jesus. Who are the friends of Jesus who are part of the divine plan? Who are to hear his message when God came down to man? They are the poor and the lonely, the sinners, as it were. They had no real credentials, but brought frankincense and myrrh. They were the tax collectors and fishermen and such. They smelled of their profession, and they weren't worth very much. They were despised streetwalkers, might well be stoned to death. They were always running. They could barely get their breath. He said, see my friends in prison and save them if you can. You could help God build a better world and be a friend to man. No, God didn't prefer the wealthy or those who had great power. He chose the weak and lowly and taught them by the hour. The message to us, my good friend, comes through both loud and clear. Go and do thou likewise means to hold all mankind dear. And another one, which is our legacy. Right now you hear, what is the governor's legacy going to be here in Pennsylvania? What is President Bush's legacy going to be? What's Bill Clinton's legacy? You hear the historians and people who are opinion leaders discussing these things right now. And I guess deep down inside, each one of us cares about our legacy, at least to some extent. Our legacy. What can I leave as a legacy that will cause folks to remember me? Not only now for those I see, but all mankind through eternity. Is it high position or awesome wealth? Or a brand new potion to enhance one's health? Can I write a poem that speaks so fine that it seems to come from our Lord divine? Being that may have no chance to be oft recalled when I join the angels' dance. There's only one who did survive, who left the world and was alive. He never ruled a great domain. Some even thought him quite insane. But he taught us all the basic truths in his early years while just a youth. He said, open up your hearts and minds and help God's children of all kinds. Yes, give him water pure to drink for those who have no house or sink. And give them food. They are so thin. They're shriveled up to bone and skin. And give them shoes and skirt or pants before they're lost to flies and ants. Then you will have your legacy. You did for them as if for me. You served them well as I can see. So welcome to eternity. And another one is along a similar line, how will you Jesus judge us? I think the thing I like about that statement that I put on my tombstone, the essence of life is unconditional, non-judgmental love, is that it's non-judgmental. So many of us spend so much time judging people. I think it might have been Mother Teresa who said, if we spend time judging people, we don't have time to love them. That sounds like it came from her. I'm pretty sure it is. How will Jesus judge us? How will the Lord on that great day decide our fate? What will he say? Will he decide we've served him well or created our own living hell? The hungry crave for food and drink, such gnawing pain they cannot think. The Master said that we shall feed and do our best to meet their need. The sick are weak and racked with pain. They're on the streets and down the lane. The Master said to give them love and pray for healing from above. And there are those who broke the law. Their hearts are cold, but they can thaw. If we but show that God forgives and let them know that Jesus lives. When we arrive on that great day and stand there, the Lord will say, you did for them as if for me. So welcome to eternity. And I think there are a lot of people, a lot of my good Christian brothers and sisters, who are great believers in punishment. And their attitude is lock them up and throw the key away. I think they admit that Jesus preached love and forgiveness, and I think they've forgotten the forgiveness, and maybe they don't understand the love. And I think a good many of our, and because of that hardline attitude on the part of our voters, our citizenship, politicians are not stupid. And you see people running for judge right now in Dauphin County who have on their literature, in their literature, how tough they've been on crime. Well, you know, I thought they're supposed to deal out justice, not the hard line of people who don't believe in love and forgiveness. And we got a lot of hardliners on the bench. We got a lot of hardliners as district attorneys. And the hardline district attorneys tend to be elected judges. And we have a system that was supposed to be uniform sentencing, and uniform sentencing on the high side. If people came out of prison in 20 years twice as good as they come out in 10 years, I'd be all for it. Unfortunately, the longer we keep them in, the less capable they are adjusting to society when they get out, because in there, all their decisions are made for them. They come on the outside without any money, without a network, and without the capacity to make decisions because they haven't done it for 10 or 15 or 20 years. That's why we've got 47,500 in our state system right now. And I wonder how many judges realize when they give a man a 20-year sentence that he's already taxing the taxpayers $1 million. Yet a lot of politicians are running the base and they're going to raise taxes. They're going to have to do something, because the cells are getting filled up. They are filled up. They're overfilled. They're overcapacitated. And there's very little forgiveness in a lot of so-called good Christian people's souls. And I'm sorry about that. More about that later. I have a grandson who's working on his doctorate, Johannesburg, in archaeology. It's my namesake, so I'm interested in all my grandchildren, but particularly in this one because he's my namesake, George Michael Leader IV. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? So he took his master, he finished his master's degree over in Johannesburg last year, and he's working on his doctorate now. He has a dig. He's just taken about 16,000 or 17,000 artifacts out of the earth over there, which are 1 million to 1.5 million years old, and they're tools and weapons. And the tools that they use to make tools and weapons, they call them stools. He's coming home for Christmas. We haven't seen him for a while, so I'm looking forward to that. But last year when he was taking his master's, he spent his weekends being a guide in a cave where one of the professors at the university there is uncovering a 3 million year old skeleton of a child. And they have to take them out very gingerly because the bones would turn to sand quickly if they do it much the way a dentist would work on it, and they make molds and so forth. And so he was working on weekends, and they had tourists on weekends, but on weekdays they have school children. And he one Wednesday, he normally worked weekdays on his master's degree, but one Wednesday they said they need a guide for the school children. Would he do it? But he accepted. He said, sure, I'll help you out, because his advisor's husband is the principal archaeologist who's working on that skeleton, so he knows them well. And they had been kind to him, and he wanted to return the favor. So he took the school children through, and as they finished, one little 9-year-old boy took his hand, and he pulled him down to where his ear was next to the little boy's mouth. And he said, "I want to be a white people too." Now, he said he knew I was American by my accent. He said he wouldn't have dared do that to a South African white, because apartheid is still an influential factor, a carryover from the days when it was really enforced. So he tried the best he could to tell that little boy that he should be the best boy he could be and the best student he could be, and hopefully to grow up to be a good black man. And I wrote a poem about that because I was deeply touched by it. Deeply touched by the fact that the separation of whites and blacks in South Africa, which is a wonderful nation in many ways, that there's still so, the differences are so great, still so great, that the separation is still so great. And I wrote a poem on that, which I hope, which I'd like to share with you. To my grandson in Johannesburg, in a land where white folks have so much to eat, they don't realize that every meal is a treat. But a little black boy just can't understand that those wealthy white people won't give him a hand. He looks at the blessings of all people white and sees this extremely beautiful sight. And he thinks as he looks with a tear in his eye, how can those white folks black people deny? Then he saw the compassion in the white student's face. He wasn't like white folks in satin and lace. And he holding his hand, asks, "What must I do so that I can become a white people too?" The white student was troubled deep down in his heart. Now what could he say to give him a start? Do all the good things as well as you can so that you will become a successful black man. We know that it's hard in a land so divided, where the status of people is already decided. To get all the training and learning, that's true, to survive with the white folks and do what they do. May God in his heavens see all that boy's needs and give him the strength to do all of the deeds that will make him a man like Nelson Mandela and avoid the hard life of the average black fella. Then the God whom we worship, who is Father of all, gives white folks a strong and unmistakable call to make note of his children regardless of race and see Jesus our brother in everyone's face. One more. I tell you, we talk about Mother Teresa a little more. A poem by Mother Teresa, carved into the wall of her home for children in Calcutta. People are often unreasonable, illogical, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people will accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you're successful, you'll win some false friends and some true enemies. Succeed anyway. If you're honest and frank, people may cheat you. Be honest and frank anyway. When you spend years building, someone may destroy, years building someone could destroy overnight, build anyway. If you find serenity and happiness, they may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today, people will forget tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best you have, and it may never be enough. Give the world the best that you have anyway. I like that. And then there's one more thing I want to say. And how's my time, Ken? Okay, yeah. I'd like to close. A couple of months ago, one night, I couldn't sleep. It's not unusual. I hate to warn you young people, when you get to be 90, sometimes sleep evades you, escapes from you. But anyhow, I turned the light on, turned on my television set, and it was 12 o'clock, and I tuned to WITF, I think you say, a public television station. And at midnight, Charlie Rose, how many of you ever heard Charlie Rose? Midnight, Charlie Rose comes on, and he always interviews interesting people. And this particular night, he was interviewing Maya Angelou, poet laureate, wonderful poet. She first came to national attention, I think, when she read an original piece of poetry at John Kennedy's inauguration in January 1961. At least that's the first I heard of her. She's been around ever since, and naturally she's growing older. So she was a mature individual in 1961. You can imagine in 2009, she must be getting up there. Charlie Rose is a very polite, considerate interviewer. And I could see he was gradually creeping up to the point that probably she isn't going to live for another 100 years. And he's very gingerly approaching it, and I don't remember the question, but I shall never forget her answer. And she said, deep down inside you, she said, there's a part of you that doesn't belong to you. It belongs to God. And he said, how should we take care of that part deep down inside of you that belongs to God? She said, by showing love and compassion and understanding and kindness and patience and forgiveness to our fellow man. I shouldn't forget that. I thought what she said was quite profound. And I would say to you, if you like some of these things, this poetry, fine. If not, just try to remember to listen to that small voice inside of you that says, be kind and considerate and charitable and forgiving with your fellow man. There are over a billion professing Christians in the world. If even half of them practice their religion, we could turn the world inside out. I'm not angry at those people on Wall Street who wrecked the world's economy because of how it affected me. I'm angry with them because just to get a few more zeros behind their name, behind their net worth on their name, they were wrecking the economy of the world, particularly the Western world, at a time when governments and foundations and individuals were getting ready and just starting to move into action to deal with the 30,000 people in Africa who die every day from disease and malnutrition. That's why I'm angry. They were willing to wreck because of their greed, they were willing to wreck the entire world economy and make charitable dollars and charitable efforts be greatly reduced. That's why I'm angry with them. I think if we could have less greed in America and in the world, and more of what Maya Angelou meant when she said, told us how to take care of that piece of our deep down inside that belongs to God, it could be a wonderful world. And I thank you for taking the time to listen to me. I was just telling the other day how welfare in the early days of the Depression was handing out food, bags of food. And then Roosevelt came along and we started giving money relief to people. And as you know, back in those days, we had about 25% unemployment. And I guess we had people on the streets of York who were selling apples for a quarter which they had bought for five or ten, probably for 5 cents. We had an orchard on our farm. We could give you a bushel of the most beautiful stamen wine sap apples for a dollar, packed in a new basket with all kinds of colored purple paper around them and so forth. We were buying 100-pound bags of potatoes in southern New York County for a dollar. They were tough times, and then Roosevelt came along, and we had the Codorus Creek, but they had to call it a river, so it became the Codorus River, and people got jobs there for about $13.45 a week or something. And I had a fellow in Sunday school that we played basketball on the Sunday school basketball team, and I said, and he was working on the creek. He was old enough that he could work and hold a job. And I said, what do you do with that $13.50 a week? He said, well, he said, I give my mother $3 for room and board, and he said, I just spend the rest of it. I couldn't imagine. I'd never held over 15 cents in my hot little hand at that time. Things were different. I lived on a poultry farm. We always had chicken and eggs. We had potatoes. Mother had a 2-acre garden. A lot of people in the rural areas. And back in those days, we were still about 50% rural. Today, now, I think we're like 10 or 11% rural. So we're not in a position. I remember Henry Ford at one time said, everybody, because back in those days, the automobile company shut down about 4 months out of the year while they were bringing out the new models. And he said, everybody should have a 5 or 10 acre tract around their house. They should have a goat or a cow, and they should graze vegetables, and they could tide themselves over while he was getting the new model out. But anyhow, I remember the Depression very well. I remember that men worked for a couple dollars a day on a farm, got one or two meals to go with it. Fortunately, where we were in a rural area, nobody went hungry. We all had a roof over. I lived, seven kids in a 5-room house without a bathroom. It wasn't, but we didn't know better, and nobody else had bathrooms either. Nobody else in the neighborhood. But there were different times, totally different times, and we were in a still pretty strongly an agricultural economy. And people didn't know how to garden, and people had gardens. And they helped each other out. And overall, I think we got through that depression remarkably well. Right now, if we had that kind of a depression, I think, if I may use the expression, ladies, all hell would break loose. I don't think our present generation, which has experienced nothing but prosperity, would take the troubles of that depression lying down. I think you'd have all kinds of problems in terms of mob rule. And I think if we're going to have a depression of the 30s now, I'd move to Australia, maybe New Zealand.